Welcome, and thank you so much for tuning in today to the Wayward Outreach Sermon. We believe that God's Word will make a major impact on your life. And if you'd like to contribute towards making an impact in someone else's life, you can visit thewaywardoutreach.org/donate. Let's check out today's sermon.
Today I'm going to talk about a really important subject, and we're going to be talking about goal setting. And 97% of people do not set goals. But this is the fact, and this is, they've done studies on this, that the 3% that do set goals, they get a vision, they write it down, they're 10 times more successful than those that do not set goals. So could it be that you're spending more time preparing for a birthday party, and you're writing down all the names of the people that you want to come to your birthday party, you're spending more time on your grocery list than you are on your life? You know what's funny? When you write your grocery list, you get what's on the paper. You know what happens when you write an invitation list? Most of those people you write down show up. There's something about writing something down. Have you ever had a to-do list? I want to get these three things done. It's surprising how those three things, or two of them, you get done. But if you didn't write it down, this is the truth, you probably wouldn't have got none of them done. So if you know you write a grocery list, and that actually you come back with the merchandise that you set on that paper, what's on that list you get, what if what's on your goal sheet you get as well? And if that is the case, and they've done studies on this, that is the case, then we are actually stealing from our destiny, our future, by not taking a little time to prepare for the year. So I'm gonna ask you to write down 10 things that you're believing for. You might think it's the silliest thing in the world, but the question we're gonna be asking right now, is this even scriptural? Does God even tell us to write things down? Does he really want us to write these things down? I'm gonna show you the spiritual meaning of this, and you're gonna be surprised if you do what God is leading us to do. I want you to understand this. This would be like a seminar that business people pay for to learn how to turn their businesses around. This people want to know how to succeed. So they'll pay hundreds or even thousands of dollars to go to a goal setting seminar to show them how to succeed. And one of the keys to succeeding in your life is finally getting your thoughts on paper. You can't build a house until the thoughts are on paper. You can't build a business without a business plan on paper. And you'll never have a successful life until you start getting dreams on paper. Has it ever happened to you, there was a great idea that you got, and you go, I'll write it down later, and you don't write it down, and you forget it? And you know what's crazy about that? You might never, ever remember it again. That thought came and went. And you know what's scary about this? Your year could come and go, dependent on the preparation you're willing to put in. And if you've never done it, it's time to start today. And one of the things about goal setting that's important, I know I have you standing up, that's good, I'm standing up. But one of the things about goal setting, it causes you to overcome your negative thinking. Because for you to write something positive about your future, you're gonna have to come against every negative thought that's coming against you, that's telling you you're disqualified, nothing good is gonna happen to you. So it's gonna force you to push out the thoughts that have been defeating you and receive the thoughts of God in your life. We need to be careful that we're not preconditioned by the devil, that nothing good could ever happen to you. I'm unworthy of anything good happening to me. It's no use for me to even start dreaming because my dreams never come true. That is not true. When you get a vision from God, it will come true because he is not a man that's going to lie to you. So we need to hear from God. God wants you to have dreams. So I'm gonna pray real quick, and we're gonna get into the word. Thank you, Jesus, for this word. Bless our downtown campus, and we're here to hear, Father. And I'm asking you, Lord, to use me to speak to your people. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I'm gonna introduce this subject. I don't know how far I'm gonna get, but I wanna introduce. Number one, you gotta get this. God wants to give you vision. God wants to give you vision. It's a promise. Let's look at Joel chapter 2, verse 28. Then after doing all these things, and another portion of scripture says this, in the last days, this is what God says, it's a promise. Say it with me, it's a promise. I will pour out my spirit upon all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. This is what he's saying. I'm gonna pour my spirit. He goes, let me talk about generations. Let's talk about your kids. I'm gonna give them inspiration from me, from my spirit. And they're gonna speak inspired by me. Their words are not gonna come from the devil. Their words aren't gonna come from the society. Their words are gonna come from me. Now, prophecy has to do with foretelling the future. They're gonna start speaking about vision. They're gonna start speaking about the future. But they're gonna get that future from my spirit. This is so good because God has a dream and God has a vision for every single young person in this room. God does not want you to be confused about your future. So this is what he's saying. Maybe you're confused about where you're headed, who you are, but God is promising this. I'm gonna pour my spirit upon all people. And it's gonna start with the young people. If you're a young person in this room, the devil wants to keep you confused about your identity, about your future, and what you're supposed to be. He's fighting against your dreams. He's fighting against you hearing from God. But this is a promise. So since this is a promise, it's important for you young people to say, God, I want to be inspired by you. It's time to stop talking nonsense, and it's time to start speaking what God has told you. Daughters will prophesy. They're going to talk about the future. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. He didn't say they might. He said they will. This is a promise. In the last days, I will pour my Holy Spirit, and this is what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna begin to reveal my will to people. Anytime that God wants to do something on earth, he reveals something to a person. And all that person needs to do is receive it. When God wants to heal somebody, he reveals it to a person. When God wants to save the city of Pomona, he gives God, a man, a vision. Let's start a church in Pomona. When God wants to reach a city like San Bernardino, he raises up a church like us with a vision to reach the Inland Empire. Anytime God wants to do something, he gives vision to a person that's ready to receive it. Is there anybody here ready to receive vision from God? And you know what's so great about vision from God? It will happen. Without vision, this is the other point I want to make, and we're introducing this. Without vision, people die. And I'm not talking about you, if you don't have a vision, all of a sudden you just croak. I'm talking about you emotionally die. I'm talking about your peace dies. Your hope dies. Your dreams die. Your dreams die. Your marriage dies. The ministry dies. Right now, there's ministries that are dying because the leaders haven't heard from God. There's families that are dying because the man of the house has not heard from God. There's organizations that are dying because leadership has no vision. Thank God we're in a church with vision. Praise the Lord for that. Proverbs 29:18. Where there is no vision, the people perish. What happens to, where there's no vision, what happens? The people under that kind of leadership, they begin to perish. That means they backslide. That's what that means. They go back. See, before you ever backslid, you stopped seeing a future, and all you seen was the past. Because what you're looking at is where you're headed. So you begin to backslide, and that word perish means, this is interesting, set to naught. Set to naught. Now that word naught is N-O-U-G-H-T. And set to naught means, it's kind of like setting your life to this word naught. And naught means zero. Setting your life to ruin. Setting your life to immorality. See, when there's immorality, the people don't have vision of God. When we have no vision, this is what happens from God, we're going towards nothing. Our life will be nothing. Our marriage will be nothing. Our future will have nothing of God in it. And this is what it's saying. It all started with no vision. And that's why the enemy finds it so easy to tempt this generation. And the reason he finds it easy to tempt a generation that doesn't believe in God, a generation that's not hearing from God, will fall for anything. We're more addicted to drugs than ever. You know why? We have no vision. Our vision, since there's no spiritual insight, when the enemy says, hey, let's get high, why not? I got nothing else to do. Why show up to counseling? I don't see no future in this. Why show up to church? For what? I don't see me doing anything great for God. So why would I show up to even get prepared? Do we understand? This is serious stuff. Without vision, people what? People perish. And that word vision means prophecy or revelation of God and his will. Say it with me. Revelation of what? Does God want to reveal his will to you? Oh man, if you could get a revelation of God's will, it will change the course of your life. This church was started by a dream that God gave me. He gave me a dream and he says, go, there's sheep out there and you're their shepherd. You know what he told me? Start a church. And you know what I did? I got that dream, and as soon as I woke up in the morning, I started talking to my wife about a dream that I got. You know who gave me that dream? The Spirit of God gave me that dream. God is ready to do what he's never done on this earth before, and he's gonna do it through regular people like me and you that are willing to say, God, speak to me, pour your Spirit upon me. I wanna get a dream. I need to get a vision. I wanna reveal your will, reveal your future, reveal what you wanna do in my life. Maybe there's somebody here that God is going to give you a vision to be a missionary, but you'll never be a missionary, and you'll never live right, and you'll never prepare until you get that vision. The enemy's going to do everything that he can to stop you from hearing what God has planned for you or your family as well. Now, let's talk about setting goals for just a second. I'm gonna give you 7 steps to setting goals, and if I get through this, it's a miracle. Number one, decide exactly what you want. Be specific. Don't you use words like more. I'm gonna give you an example. I wanna read more of the Bible. That's not a goal. Now, if you're saying I wanna read through the book of Romans in the month of January, that's a goal. Put a number on it. I want to lose more weight. That's not a goal. I want to lose 10 pounds. Now that's a goal. Okay. I want to do more ministry. That's not a goal. I'm going to sign up for ministry by January 31st, and I will be involved in the ministry by then. You got to put specifics on it, or there's no commitment to it. You guys get that? God will give us what we want. Now, this is a big question. So you're telling me to decide what I want? Is God gonna give me my wants, or is he gonna give me my needs? I'm not sure. See, we need to know this, because I'm telling you that God will give you what you want. But the question is, will God give you what you want? I'm going to answer that question right now. And let's look at John 15, 7. Now, there's a qualification. Someone say qualification. God will give us what we want. He will give us what we want. Now, I'm going to read this scripture in a minute. If we follow his teachings. Someone say qualification. God will give every single person what they want if they were a follower of Jesus' teachings. Now, this is what it means. A follower, why would God give you what you want if you follow his teachings? This is why. Because your goal is to do God's will. And once your goal is to do God's will, your heart's in the right place. And when your heart's in the right place, you're gonna want what he wants. So the stipulation here is, those that follow my instructions could ask me whatever they want because I'm leading them. And if I could lead them in their daily life, I could lead them in their dreams and vision as well. Let's look at the scripture, John 15, 7. Stay joined together with me. This is what Jesus said. So what does Jesus want us to do? Stay joined together with me. I want you to be close to me. Don't depart from me. And follow my teachings. He's saying here, don't just be a hearer of the word, be a what? Now, understand this. If you're a doer of the word, you qualify for prayers to be answered. And I want you to get, you qualify for prayers to be answered. And those that do not follow Jesus' teachings, do not, this scripture does not apply to them. Now, this is serious stuff. Look at this, good though. Look at this. Stay joining me. I don't know what's popping. We have a gun around here? Okay. Stay joined together with me. Follow my teachings. If you do this, you can ask for anything you want, and it will be given to you. Wow. This is the truth. How can you have confidence in your prayers if you don't have confidence in the Spirit's leading? The reason I obey God, there's a reason I obey God, because I believe that he's a rewarder for those who diligently seek him. So I believe if I do his will, it's gonna be for my benefit. God's not leading me to pain and hurt and defeat and depression. God's leading me out of that. See, it takes faith to obey God. It also takes faith to get a prayer answered. And someone might be asking, do I have enough faith? I don't know if I have enough faith. Well, this is the proof that you have enough faith, that when God asks you to do something, you do it even when you don't want to do it, but you do it because you trust God. There's a time in your life that God's gonna give you instructions and it's gonna go against every fiber of your flesh. It's not gonna make sense. I remember, Veronica, you were laughing about this, but I remember when God told you guys to go full-time ministry. And we just started it. Robert, you guys are gonna have to go full-time ministry. They just got married. They just got married and now they're getting ready to go to full-time ministry. And what this meant was Veronica just got saved too. And now she was gonna be a pastor's wife. She barely knew what it meant to be a Christian. And then Robert had to leave his $70,000 a year job for I don't know what, because there was no finances coming in. And I remember they started praying and they started fasting and they started crying. That literally happened. And then my brother calls me up. He says, we've heard from God. We're gonna step out in faith. See, now, when you're willing to step out in faith like that, it proves you have faith. And if you can follow God's lead and obey his instruction in everything he tells you to do, this is what he's saying. You can ask me for anything you want. and I will give it to you. Oh, I love that. Is that good? Just decide exactly what you want. So write down on that list what you want. And the second step is write it down. Someone say, write it down. This is when we take a vision from the unseen world and bring it into the natural realm. This is where we take the vision from the unseen world and take it into the what? Natural realm. So this is where we take a vision from our minds and our hearts, our spirit, and we bring it into the physical. Oh.
Can you hear me? Oh, there you go.
All right. This, understand, until you write it down, it's still in the spiritual realm. When you write it down, you just brought it into the physical realm. And until you write it down, it's still in the wrong realm. You gotta bring it into the physical realm. When God has determined to do something new in our lives or this world, he gives us a vision and we receive it when we write it down. One of the big things about prayer is not just you giving your request before God, God giving his request to you. How many understand a two-way street? There's things that God wants to reveal and wants to get done in your life. You know, it's not a, we've all been in trouble and we've all been gone through trials, but this is good news. No matter what trial you've gone through, there's a word from God for that trial. And if God gives you a word, it gives you the strength to get through it. It gives you the courage to get through it. It gives you the faith to get through it. This is why the enemy doesn't want us to have quiet time, keeping us busy. And the truth is, most Christians don't pray. Most Christians, they know everything that's going on YouTube. They know everything that's going on Facebook. They know everything that's going on in this world. They know everything that Donald Trump is doing and the Clintons are doing. But the question is, do you even know what God's trying to do in your life? I love when people are hearing from God and they know that God said it. Because once someone knows that they've heard from God, there's no devil that can convince you otherwise. Because see, you didn't get this from your pizza last night. You didn't get this from some fruity dream. You got this from the Holy Spirit. And once God gives you that, you're like a pit bull that grabs on, that doesn't let go. Because it wasn't a man that revealed this to me. It was God that gave me this thing. And I'm not giving up until I see it come to pass. But someone say, write it down. When God is determined to do something new in our lives, he gives us a vision. We receive it when we write it down. Look at Revelation 21:5, I'm sorry. And the one sitting on the throne, I love this. Who's sitting on the throne? Jesus. He's sitting on the throne, this is what he says. Look, I am making everything new. Oh, I love this. You know what he says? Take a look at it. Get a vision. What you're going through right now, I'm making all that brand new. Stop focusing on the mess you got now. Stop focusing on how your marriage is right now. Stop focusing on how your body is right now. Stop focusing on your past right now. Look, I'm gonna make everything brand new. Someone needs to receive this word for themselves. Something is coming new down the chute. And you know what he's saying? Take your eyes off the mess. Take your eyes off the haters. Take your eyes off the struggle. Take your eyes off the bank account. Take your eyes off your inability. Take your eyes off the past. And look, I'm ready to do something new. And you know who gets new? The ones that get their minds and hearts refocused. God can't do something new if you keep focusing on the same mess. I'm gonna ask you right now, what you looking at? What are you looking at? What are you focused on? Because whatever you're focused on, that's where you're headed. Did your enemy capture you at your job? And all you're doing is focusing on them. This is crazy.
has lust captured you, and every secret minute you have, you're looking on a lustful images. The truth is, as long as you keep looking at that, this is what what's wrong with pornography? This is the problem. I'm going to give you a spiritual reason what's wrong with this thing, because as long as you're looking at that, you can't look at what God is doing. Some of you right now need to overcome jealousy. You keep looking at the phone records. You keep trying. You're doing an investigation on your wife and on your husband. And God is saying, as long as you're looking at that, I can't even do a new thing in your husband. I can't do a new thing in your life because your focus is on the wrong thing. I'm the one that can change him. You're not going to fix her. You're not going to fix him. Get your eyes from there and look. I'm doing a new thing. How do I know what you're looking at? Because what you're looking at, you're talking about. Look, this is what he said. Look, I'm making everything new. The one on the throne saying this, look, I'm making everything new. I've never read this scripture in 12 years in this church. This scripture is prophetic for you. Look, I'm making everything. See, you're in transition now, and you're, why am I in transition? I'm making everything new. I know you don't like the transition because it's uncomfortable for you, but I'm making everything new. So I got to pull you out of your comfort zone. I got to pull you out of that place that you just want to settle in. I'm doing something new. It's time to get excited. God's doing something new. And he says, and then he said to me, now, this is where we receive it. Say with me, this is where we receive it. You'll never see something new without the second part. Write this down. What did he tell him? See that thing I just showed you of new thing? Write it down. Do you see yourself new without struggling, without addiction? Write it down. Do you see your marriage restored? Come on, am I showing you that? Write it down. Do you see yourself healthy and strong? Write it down. Do you see yourself complete in school? Write it down. Do you see yourself in ministry? Write it down. Come on. God is saying, come on, I want to give you vision, but this is important. Once I show you the new thing I'm ready to do in your life, someone say, write it down. Write it down for what I tell you and for what I show you is trustworthy and true. You know what he's saying? I'm not going to tease you. If I'm telling you something and I'm revealing it to you, you can bank on it. It's going to happen. I love this. We're doing worldwide ministry. We're going to start a church in Pomona. You know why? God's revealed this. We're going to do it. We're going to start satellite churches in prisons. How do we know? We're going to do it. We're going to buy a family home for women. How do you know? It's a trustworthy saying. God showed me. I wrote it down. It's going to happen. I wrote down. I'm telling you, if you write down a list at grocery store and you come back with the stuff, I wrote down, this is part of my grocery list, I wrote down Lisa. God, I want God that loves you more than I love you. That's what I wrote down. So everything that came that didn't look like that, I go, you're not it. And this is why we're all confused, because we don't even have vision from God. So anybody could take the place of nothing. You don't even know what you're looking for, because you've not got revelation from God. See, some of you are desperate because you have no vision. You get depressed because you have no vision. All you can see is the mess in front of you. We walk by faith, not by sight. So this is what I want you to do. Write down 10 goals you want to accomplish this year. In the next 12 months, spiritual, family, financial, physical, personal, possessions, all that stuff. Step number 3, choose one of the 10 goals. You know what we're doing is, some of us can't win because we're trying to win all over the place. There's a time in your life that you got to get focused. Someone say focus. You write 10 goals. Focus on one that you're going to work on in the next 30 days, 90 days. Focus on one. Let's put a circle around that one you're going to focus on. This is where we begin to prioritize our goals. There's goals that have priorities. You know what that means is? You write 10 goals. There's some of those goals that don't have top priority, but you got to pick the one that will maximize your life. It might be the hardest one, but you have to know what you're working on. If I came up to you and I said, what goal are you working on right now? And if you don't have an answer, this is the idea. You have no vision. And if you have no vision, this is what I know. The areas you have no vision in are all going to end up being zeros. They're all going to be ruined. They're all going to be in chaos. Parents, we need to start getting some vision for our kids too. Vision for ministry. I'm excited. We're doing worldwide ministry pretty soon. Okay? Proverbs 24:27. It says this. Prepare your work outside. This is showing priority. And get it ready for yourself. And get it ready for yourself in the field. Afterward. Say with me. Afterward. Build your house and establish a home. You know, what, he said, what does that have to do with goal setting? It's prioritizing. So what he's saying is, you're a farmer. And before you start building your house, make sure you set up a field. Get some income first. Don't put the cart before the horse and build this beautiful house and you have no income coming in from the field. She goes, get your field all planted up, ready to go, and then all you have to do is water it and then go build your house. Because if you do it out of order, you're going to have a nice house and you're not going to have no income to pay for it. Someone say priority. So he's telling you, work on the field first, then do this. So you got to decide, God, I have these 10 goals that you've given me. You've given me vision. Which one do I operate on first? And God will reveal that to you. Step number 4, get a plan from God. That means once you get a goal that you're going to be working on, ask God, how is that going to happen? Man, I want to start a business. Okay, you want to start a business. What kind of business? This kind of business. How are you going to do that? What's your steps that you need to take to get there? I want to become a doctor. Well, how are you going to do that? That's the plan. Because wishing and hoping is not enough. You need a plan. Someone say you need a plan. Right? I want to be a full-time ministry. Well, how are you going to do that? There has to be a plan. No matter what I want to raise godly children. Well, how are you going to do that? You need to have a plan. I want to have a healthy marriage. Well, how are you going to do that? What's the plan? Well, we're just wishing and hoping. It's not gonna work. Look at this, what it says about planning. Look at this. In Proverbs, a well thought out plan works. Say it with me. A well thought out plan works. Proverbs 21:5. A well thought out plan will work to your advantage, but hasty actions will cost you dearly. This is what he's saying. You wanna get married, but there's a question. Have you prepared for that? It's important. I wanna accomplish great things. How are you going to do that? Okay, so this is what it says. A well thought out plan will work to your advantage. So when we think about it and say, God, give me a plan, this is what God will begin to do. As soon as you write a goal, this is what God begin to do. He will give you a step-by-step plan how to get that thing done. And when God gives you a plan, it will work. Remember the A-team? I love when the plan comes together. Oh, I love this. I love challenges. Because with every challenge, there's a vision from God. With every challenge, there's a plan from God. There's no challenge that you're facing that you cannot conquer because God has a plan to overcome that thing. That's why the Bible says when you're going through trials and tribulations, he didn't say pray to get out. He said ask for wisdom. You know what he said? Ask for the strategy. Ask for the plan. And if you get the plan, this is what's going to happen. You'll overcome the problem. I love it. You know why? Because I can help people. Now, when you start getting a plan, this is what I want you to do. I'm going to give you real quick. I want you to write down 20 things. This is called mindstorming. 20 things that you can do to accomplish that goal. Say it with me, mindstorming. 20 things that you could do to accomplish that goal. Now, the first 5 are going to be easy. The next 5 are going to be difficult. The last 10 are going to be super hard. I'll tell you why. Because now you're digging for creativity. And when you start digging at that level, God will start dropping thoughts in your mind that you've never had before. God is looking for someone that's looking for wisdom. I love this. Number 5. Oh man, there's a miracle ready to happen right before your eyes. Set a deadline for goal. Someone say deadline. That means don't set a goal like, I want to go to school. When? you know, when it happens. I want to clean the yard. When I get around to it. Okay. Because as long as you don't have a deadline, you know what it is? It's not a real goal. And I'll tell you this, you're not even committed to your own dreams. Even Jesus set a deadline on his resurrection. Look at Matthew 16:21. From then on, Jesus began to tell his disciples plainly that it was necessary for him to go to Jerusalem, that he would suffer many terrible things. Teachers from religious law, he would be killed, but on the third day, he would be raised from the dead. So Jesus says, I'm going to die, but this is the deadline. On the third day, expect me to rise from the dead. God set a deadline even when they were going to Jericho. He goes, you're going to walk around Jericho six times, and on the seventh day, you're going to walk around seven times. You're going to blow the trumpet, and the walls are going to come down. So even God had a goal for the walls to come down, but he also had a goal, and he put a deadline on the goal. It's important. A goal without a deadline is just a wish. That's what we're setting goals and deadlines on. The 29th, we're bringing our first fruit. The 22nd, we're bringing our goals. We're doing impartation on the 25th. All those were goals, but without deadlines on them, they don't materialize. All right? So, number six, how do I set goals? Take action on the plan immediately. Select one of the 20 action steps and move forward. A plan without action will not produce any results. Someone say, take action. Now, this is a big thing. You can set goals in any area of your life, but if you never take action, and not action someday, action immediately. The Bible says today is a day of salvation. We got to stop saying, one of these days I'm going to get right. One of these days I'm going to go to counseling. One of these days I'm going to serve. How about immediately? How about right now? Because the minute you begin to take action is the beginning of your new life. God wants to do something new. Even though he gives you a vision, he gives you a plan. But if you never work on it, it never comes to pass. So James 2:17 says this, the same is true with faith. Without actions, faith is useless. By itself, it is as good as dead. And I want to make one more point on this. Either we will execute or make excuses. Say with me, either we will execute or make what? Look at this. And I want you to think about it. There's people doing some amazing things at a young age, at an older age. They're doing some. Colonel Sanders, he set a goal to Kentucky Fried Chicken. That guy was like 80 years old. Right? He just made up his mind. I'm going to do something. There's a lot of young people right now doing amazing things. And the only difference is that they're setting goals. I set a goal. We're going to have a great marriage. I just made up my mind. And we started working on that, working the plan. And I can tell you right now, 27 years, we got a great marriage. But it had to be a goal. We had to work on that thing. Look at the scriptures. I love this scripture. The lazy person claims there's a lion out there. If I go outside, I might be killed. You know what that means? Is that the lazy person, what's the lazy person? One that refuses to take the action that he should. Now this person, instead of executing, what is he doing? He's coming up with what? He's coming up with excuses. That was Proverbs 22:13. So any excuse will do if you're not willing to take action, right? And step number seven, man, we got it. Work hard on goals every day. Say it with me. Work hard on what? I don't know where we get this from, but if you're ever going to be successful, this is an attribute that you're going to have. You're going to have to work hard. Some people think this, it's luck. It's not luck. You understand that? Someone said it takes a lot of work. As a matter of fact, it's going to take more work than you think. When I look at even the results we're getting in this church, I'm excited about what we're getting. The truth is, I think we should have 300,000 people in this church with all the work we put in. You understand that? It's not luck. We're going to put in work. Plans of people who work hard succeed. Say it with me. Plans of people who work hard. What? Proverbs 21:5, it says this. The plans of people who work hard succeed. You can be just as sure that those who in a hurry will become poor. You know what it's saying? Those that don't take time to plan their lives, he says, I'll guarantee you this, they'll be in lack in every area that they've not set goals in, they've not worked hard in, because they're expecting something for free. And this is what happens. It's a lotto mentality. If I could just buy a ticket, it will all happen. That's why Las Vegas is rich. Because we want, this is what we want. We want success without hard work. We believe more in Lady Luck than we do in sweat. This is what happens. Those people that are hurrying, that aren't setting goals, that aren't working hard, this is where they end up, in total poverty. Because and this is the truth, they know what to do, but they don't do it, or they barely work the plan. See, we got too many employees that this is what they think. That's not my job description. How about you going there and working as unto the Lord and working with all your might? I'll work everybody in your industry and watch God prosper you, because you're representing the King of Kings. Now, this is important. Create a daily, work on it. Some will say, work on it every day. Create a daily to-do list that will lead to your goals being accomplished. So you should wake up every morning and just do one or five things that has to do with your goals. Now, all this stuff I'm telling you, it will work if you work it. And last thing I'm going to say, don't let the enemy discourage you. Say it with me. Don't let the enemy discourage you. Because as you're moving forward, the enemy's going to tell you, it's not working. Nehemiah 6:9. They were trying to intimidate us, imagining that they could discourage us and stop the work. So I continued the work with even greater determination. What he's saying, there might be a group of people or a situation that tries to intimidate you and stop you from moving forward with the work of the Lord. There's going to be no vision that God gives you without an enemy that's going to do everything that he can to discourage you. He's going to try to get in your head. He's going to try to get in your emotions. He's going to try to give you bad news. He's going to try to give you proof that it's not working. And this is what Nehemiah said. They tried to intimidate us. They thought by their words and making it hard for us that they were going to stop us from working, stop us from putting in effort. But I made up my mind that I was going to be more determined than ever, because this vision I did not get from man. This vision I got from God. So you could threaten me, you could put me in prison, you could talk about me, but the more you talk about me, the more I get excited about the call on my life, because now I know it must be from God. Because why would the devil be fighting me so hard if God wasn't all up in this thing? See, the devil does not mess with people that aren't on a plan, because he already has them locked down. Some of you right now have a vision, but you've been more discouraged than you've ever been. And this is what God is saying. This is not a time to give up. This is a time to get more determined than you've ever been, because God said, I gave you the vision. I gave you the dream. I'm the one that downloaded your future. You better realize who gave it to you. It's a trustworthy thing. I'm not a man that should lie. See, the vision will come to pass, even though it delays. Don't you trip. It will come to pass, because I'm the one that declared it. I'm the one that showed you. Your best days are ahead of you. You will end up in victory. You will fulfill your purpose. You will be happy. You will be restored. Your kids will serve God. Right now, it's time for somebody to start getting excited about what God said, and you let the enemy know.
You could threaten me. You could intimidate me. You could try to discourage me. But I know this, that it's my God that's the one that gave me this vision to rebuild this city. And I will do it with God's help. Now I'm more determined than ever. How bad do you want the dream? Come on. How bad do you want it? Let's all stand up.
Thank you so much for tuning in today and watching today's sermon. We pray that God's word makes a lasting impact in your life. If you'd like to share your story with us, then send us an email to mystory@thewayworldoutreach.org. Thanks again. We love you and have a wonderful day.